Welcome back. In this video and the next couple of videos, we are going to talk about sequential data. This is chapter 7 in the book. So in this first video of this series, we are going to talk about sequential data in abstract terms, so to say. So we are going to review four properties that we have seen before in the video where we compared abstract data types versus concrete data types. And we review four properties that every sequence, so to say, has. So to do that, let's create a new notebook and simply rename it into sequences. So let me give you two examples of a sequence. The first one is going to be simply a list of numbers. And as we do in this course many times, let's simply take the list of numbers from 10 through 12. This time I provide it to you in order. Usually we do that with random order, but here the numbers are provided in order. And let's also create a second object, which I call text. And this is simply going to be a text, let's say lorem ipsum. And I think it is solor dolor sit amid. Okay, so the question now is, what do these two objects have in common? So first of all, note that both have a different data type. So in memory, they will look different. So if I ask the Python the built-in type function and I call it once for numbers and I call it once for text, then what we get is we get the answer that numbers is a list object and the text is a string object. Okay, so what is the commonality? So the commonality is that both are sequences. Okay, so let's write that down. Both are so-called sequences. And sequences are a special breed of a so-called collection. And a collection is also a term just like sequences that is formalized in the Python documentation. So let's also write that down. Sequences, a special version of collections. So let's review the properties. So the first property we are going to review is the so-called container property. So let's make this a header maybe. So the container property. And the container property simply means an object in abstract terms contains references to other objects. So how can we see that with the numbers and text example? Well, we can see that by using the in operator. So let's go ahead and check if the number 0 is in numbers. And it is not that we get back false as the answer here. The more important thing is that the in operator works with numbers as the right operand. And in the similar spirit, we can go ahead and check if the letter O is in the text, and this also works. And this time we get back true. So the answer, true or false, is not the important thing here. The important thing is that the in operator itself works. So I give you an example of of a situation where the in operator does not work. So let's say, let's go ahead and take the number 333. And the number consists of three digits, so to say. And we could ask the question, is the digit 3 in the number 333? And to us humans, we would say yes. But in this case, to Python, the question doesn't make sense. So this is why we see a type error. So in other words, the in operator does not work with the integer data type. So in other words, the integer data type does not have the container property. Okay, but the list data type and the string data type, they have. So you may wonder, how can I come up with these terms? And I told you earlier that these terms are formalized in the documentation. There's another way of how to look up these names or how to see that the names must be correct. From the standard library, let's go ahead and import from the collections module the so-called ABC submodule from the collections module. And let's import it as simply ABC. Okay, ABC stands for abstract base class. In other words, this is basically the fancy term for an abstract data type. And there are a couple of them that are defined on the ABC object here. One of them is going to be the container property. So let's go ahead and we see that Container indeed is a class. So class we will see in chapter 10, which is a bit advanced, but a class is basically a blueprint for how to construct objects of this data type. And we have seen classes before, the built-in classes like int and list. They are also what we called the constructor functions. This is basically the two sides of the same coin here. So what can we do with the container ABC, the container abstract base class? Well, the only thing that we could really do is we could use Python's isInstance function, isInstance, and we could check if numbers, which is a list, is also, so let's go ahead and check if numbers is a list. Python tells me, yes, numbers is a list. It is an instance of a list. But also, instead of using a concrete data type here, what we could do is we could use the abstract data type. So let's go ahead and ask if numbers is a container in abstract terms. And the answer is true as well. Okay. And the same, of course, holds true for the text object. So if I ask Python, hey, is text, the object, the string object, also a container, then Python will confirm to me, yes, it is a container. And just to illustrate the point that for the digit 300, for the number 333, we get a type error here. We could, of course, also go ahead and ask the question, is the number 333 also a container? And the answer is, in this case, false. So a true here means the in operator is supported. A false here means the in operator is not supported. So there's a one-to-one correspondence. So usually, when programming, you don't see the ABC module here used that often. Okay, it is a bit of an abstract thing, and there are cases where we want to use it. But for a beginner, it is not so important to understand the ABC module here. I'm just illustrating here that you see that the terms I come up with, they actually exist somewhere in the core of Python. In this case, in the standard library. Okay. So that is one property, the container property, but there are a couple of more properties. So another important property, which we already also saw in the video abstract data types versus concrete data types, is the property of, we call it sized. And the sized property simply means, does the object contain a finite number of references? So we are a container here because we contain references to other objects. But now the question is, is the number of references to other objects, is it finite or is it infinite? And the answer is, if an object is a so-called sized object, then the number is finite, of course. And what does that mean when coding? Well, for coding purposes, this means that the object supports being used as the argument to the len built-in function. Okay, so if I call the len function and I pass to it numbers, I get back 12, which is the number of numbers in the numbers list here. If I go ahead and call the len function and I pass it text, I get back 27. Why 27? Well, 27 is the number of characters in the text object here. Okay, the number of Unicode characters to be precise. Now, let's go ahead and also call the len function and let's pass to it the number 333. So we could imagine that we as humans, when we view a number with three digits, then we could think of the length of the number to be three, for example, because it has three digits in it, right? So if I execute this, I get a type error again. And what we learn from that is that the integer data type is also not a sized data type, okay? So the integer data type is neither a container nor a sized data type, but both the numbers and the text objects, so the list and the string objects, they are both container and sized data types. So it doesn't stop here. So what I'm not doing here is I'm not doing the example with the ABC module here for the sized thing here, for the size property, but this could also be done. But let's simply go ahead to two more properties. So the third property is what we simply refer to as the iterable property. And the iterable property simply means we can loop over an object. So let's try that out. Let's loop over the numbers list. And we already know that this works because in the very first example of this course, we already looped over a list. So we know that this has to work. So I simply go ahead and say for number in numbers. So I'm using numbers, the list object, as the target over which I'm looping. And let's do something very simple. Let's say print, let's say number, let's square it. And let's also print everything on one line. And now we have the square numbers from 1 through 12. Okay, quite simple, but the important idea is we can loop over the numbers object. And therefore, the numbers object is iterable. Now, let's do the same exercise with the text object. And as we already saw in the previous videos where we talked about the string data type in detail, we can also loop over the text object here. So we can say for character in text, and let's simply say print character, and let's simply put one space in between all the characters. And then we get the same sentence printed out, but there is a space in between every character. Okay, so the important idea here is not that we can loop over them, but the important idea is that the important idea is not that the list and the text and the string object define looping on their own, so to say, but the big idea is that both share the commonality, both share the same behavior in this regard, and we call it the iterable behavior. And if we do that with the number 333, so if I say for example, for digit in 333, print digit, I am also simply going to get a type error because a int data type, again, is not iterable here. Okay, so why are these three properties so important? So container, sized, and iterable, because they make up the term collection, or the, let's call it the meta property of a collection. So let's write that down here in parentheses, first three properties. That is what a collection is, okay? And now, every collection that also has one more property is what we call a sequence. And this fourth property that is so important, we can use the formal name, but we can also use an easier name. So the formal name would be reversible. And the easier way would simply be ordered. So a data type that models some order. So in other words, the numbers in the list are ordered, but also the characters in the string are ordered. That is what we refer to as a reversible data type. And reversible is just a fancy name here because if something can be reversed, it has to have a forward order to begin with, otherwise we couldn't reverse it, right? So let's try that out rather quickly. And let's simply copy-paste the for loop from above. And one way to check if something is reversible is to simply use it as the argument to the reversed built-in. So if I say for number in reverse numbers, I get the square numbers in reverse order. And of course, if we do that for the string object as well, we will see that this also works. Okay, and all the objects in Python, all data types in Python that support all the four properties here are what we call sequences. And sequences are in particular valuable when we want to model sequential data. And now you may wonder, why do I focus so much on sequences and the four properties? Well, the reason is almost a lot of the data that we as business people work with in data science, for example, are sequential data. So whenever you open an Excel file or a CSV file, that is sequential data. Okay, vectors are sequential data, matrices are sequential data, and a lot more other things. So all the data that you typically store in an SQL database, they can be viewed as a sequential data set and so on. So everything we are going to learn in this big chapter, in chapter 7, that talks about sequential data in general, this will fulfill these four properties, and you can always relate it into your head to basically working with Excel-like data in a programming language. Okay, so this video here is basically a review or a focused video continuing from the abstract versus concrete data types video earlier in the course. And here we are focusing in particular on sequential data. Now you understood everything you need to know in generic terms about sequential data. And again, you could check it in code using the ABC module, but as a beginner, you probably won't need that too often. But long-term, in a long-term basis, I think it's very valuable to also look into the ABC module. Other than that, simply know the four properties. And the big reason why you as a beginner should know these four properties is if we go into the Python documentation. So let's, for example, go into the library reference and into the page that we have so far seen the most, the built-in functions page. If I go ahead and look for, let's say, iterable, we will find it very, very often. And now you know what that means. Iterable is simply any object over which we can loop. It can be a list, but it can also be a string. We don't care. Any object that we can loop over in abstract terms. And also the term sequence, you will find very often. So if you look for SEQ, you get 28 search hits here. So knowing these terms is not only valuable for theory, but it's also valuable for learning how to read documentation. And when you can do that, when you learn how to read the documentation efficiently, then you will become a good programmer quite soon. So I will see you in the next video when we talk about the list data type. See you then.